listening to the Zero Hour. Rest your eyes. Exercise your imagination. Today, Glenn Hall Taylor's offbeat story of people who play with matches and death. Come light my fire. Starring Peter Lupus. In the Mutual Broadcasting System presentation of The Zero Hour.
Brought to you by the Ford Motor Company and Lazy Boy Recliners. Also by State Farm Insurance, International Harvester, and Quaker State Motor Oil. This is The Zero Hour on Mutual Radio.
Under common law, the willful and malicious burning of another person's house was considered to be a crime as heinous as that of murder, a felony punishable by death. Today's story is about both arson and murder. It begins in a modestly impressive home in a respectable middle-class neighborhood where David and Eleanor Scott have resided for the past few years. But the man who has successfully posed as a retired insurance consultant doesn't consult in the manner in which his neighbors might anticipate. Listen.
Come in. We're expecting you.
Hi, Mr. Scott.
Hello, Mr. Porter. Well, I take it this is the gentleman you telephoned about.
Yes, it's Mr. Gilpin.
Glad to know you, Mr. Gilpin.
How do you do?
Have a chair, gentlemen.
Mrs. Scott and Mr. Gilpin.
Oh, hello. How do you do?
Well, let's get down to business. Mr. Porter tells me you have a problem. May I ask what it is?
Well, I think I'd rather have Mr. Porter explain it.
Yeah, well, I'd be glad to. See, Mr. Gilpin owns a tenement house on the other side of town. Well, pretty soon the building will create big losses because it needs new plumbing, wiring throughout, replacement of dry-rotted timbers, and so on.
Well, as an insurance consultant, I'm interested in your coverage. Do you have enough insurance to be in the market for a successful fire?
Yes, but I hesitate.
Oh, for heaven's sake, that's nothing to be ashamed of.
You see, Mr. Gilpin, I told you these were okay folks.
Well, it's nice of you to say that.
Do they guarantee results and confidentiality?
Oh, Mr. Gilpin, we've been doing this nearly all our lives.
And I might add, we're not pyromaniacs. We merely set a fire and walk away.
You see, with us, it's a profession.
Well, that makes me feel a little better about it. I'm a respectable businessman, and nothing must go wrong so that I become involved.
We protect all our clients. Now, please don't worry.
Well, I guess that about sums everything up. I presume Mr. Porter told you about our fee?
Yes, it's quite satisfactory.
Good. We appreciate your business, Mr. Gilpin.
Yes, miss. May I help you?
I think so. Are you the arson investigator, Mr. Atherton?
Yes.
I heard on the radio that you were in charge of investigating that tenement fire in the north side of town.
Do you know something about it?
Well, I'm not sure, but I think so. See, I lived in an apartment in that building, shared it with a girlfriend. We lost everything.
Were you in the building at the time of the fire?
No, sir. I was at work. But yesterday afternoon, I was leaving for the factory, and I noticed something that I thought I should report to you.
What was that?
Well, there were two old people, a man and a woman down in the lower hall. I'd never seen either of them before.
Were they acting suspicious?
I didn't think so at the time, but later I began to wonder about what they were doing.
What were they doing?
Well, she was on her knees under the staircase. I stopped to see what was wrong, and she told me she'd lost her key. Now, just as I asked if I could help her look for it, she said she'd found it, so I left.
Anything else?
Yeah, as I went out the front door, I noticed a car parked to the curb. A man was sitting at the wheel and the motor was running.
That could be a coincidence.
I know. But when I got to the corner where I wait for my bus, I happened to look back and saw the old couple getting into the car, and it took off kind of fast.
About what time was that?
3. Almost exactly. See, I worked the 4 to midnight shift at the factory, and I leave the house every day at 3. That was another reason I thought maybe it tied in. The radio report said that a fire broke out a little after 3.
Right. Can you describe the people you saw yesterday?
I didn't get a good look at the old couple. It was pretty dark in their hall.
How about the driver of the car?
I got a pretty good look at him.
Do you know who owned the apartment?
I heard his name was Gilpin. But we always paid our rent to Mr. Brown, the manager. He and his wife lived in the building, too. I don't know where they've gone since the fire.
Anything else you think would be of help?
Afraid not.
Well, thank you for contacting me. Your concern is very much appreciated. Now then, let me fill in this report on the description of that driver, and I'll let you go. Okay, your name, please. This will be kept confidential.
Carol Kent. 2 R's and 2 L's in Carol.
And believe me, Miss Kent, we'll investigate this thoroughly. Arson, investigator Atherton. Oh, sure, Chief. Yeah, I showed that Carol Kent the mugshots I got from police headquarters, and she made a positive identification of a guy named Porter. He's the guy she saw sitting in the car. Yeah. As a matter of fact, he's been mixed up in half a dozen arson cases. I sent word out to have him picked up. Yeah, meantime, I dropped by that guy Gilpin's office and laid Miss Kent's story right on him. He was scared, I can tell you. And I tipped off the insurance company. Okay, Chief. Right. I'll stay on it. Talk to you later.
Well, come right in, Mr. Gilpin.
Thank you.
David.
It's Mr. Gilpin, Ellie.
Oh, what a pleasant surprise.
No, Mrs. Scott, I'm afraid it's not pleasant. An investigator from the arson squad called on me.
Are they suspicious?
Oh, plenty.
I don't understand. The fire we set under that rickety old staircase wouldn't have left any evidence. And what remained of it couldn't have been separated from the rest of the ashes.
No. It wasn't your technique. Someone saw you.
I wonder who
it was.
Could
that nice young lady who offered to help me find the key I told her I'd lost.
Well, she didn't identify you two, but she described Porter and they're after him.
Oh, now, isn't that provoking?
Provoking? Is that your only reaction? This could be the ruination of all of us if Porter talks.
I don't think there's much chance of that, Mr. Gilpin. Once Porter gets wind of it, he'll be out of town before you can wink an eye.
Oh, so that's why.
That's why what, Mr. Gilpin?
Well, it just struck me. I mean, that's probably why I haven't been able to contact him since this morning. When he came to my office and I paid him for the job.
Now, just a second, Mr. Gilpin. You paid Mr. Porter?
Yes.
Our share, too?
Well, of course.
Oh, that's most distressing.
Well, that was the agreement.
But if he skips town, that means he's going to cut out with our share.
Oh, well, I'm afraid that's no concern of mine.
Oh, we understand that, Mr. Gilpin. Mm-hmm. It's just that this is a little unexpected.
Mr. Gilpin, if you'll excuse us, I think we'd better call on Mr. Porter.
Well, would it help if I went with you?
I don't think so. He has an apartment he uses for a sort of hideaway. And I'm sure he wouldn't appreciate our letting anyone else know about it.
Well, I hope you settle everything satisfactorily.
Oh, we will, Mr. Gilpin. We will.
Yes? Who is it?
Dave Scott.
Just thought we'd pay you a call, Mr. Porter. Maybe come in?
Yes, of course.
Nice little place you've got here.
Oh, I see you're packing some luggage. Going somewhere?
I told Mr. Gilpin you'd take it on the lam as soon as you found out.
Found out what?
About the police and the arson investigators looking for you.
How do you know about that?
Mr. Gilpin told us.
What did you come here for?
Well, we were afraid that in the excitement of trying to get away, you might overlook us.
What do you mean?
We thought you might forget to pay us.
Me? You get paid by Mr. Gilpin.
He's told us he's already paid you.
Oh, you're nuts. Gilpin's trying to welch on the deal and not pay any of us.
Mr. Porter, I do believe you're attempting to be dishonest.
Look, I'm hot and I gotta get out of town.
Then give us our money and you can be on your way.
No dice. You old fogies ought to figure you're lucky you weren't spotted in that tenement building yesterday. Getting away with your skin should be enough of a payoff for you.
We took the same chance you did.
And we expect to be paid for it.
What do you want me to do, get picked up? That's what's going to happen if you don't let me get going. And if I do get picked up on account of you stalling me here, I'll blow the whistle on you.
Oh, my. I had no idea you could be so unpleasant, Mr. Porter.
I'll get a lot more unpleasant if you two old coots don't get out of my way. Hey, hold up. What's the gun for?
We've been very patient, Mr. Porter, but patience is obviously getting us nowhere. We have now arrived at the moment of truth.
Give me that gun, you old man. You can...
I'm afraid I've killed him, Ellie. I really didn't want to.
Well, now, David, I'll go through his luggage and you search his pockets. It would be a shame not to get our money after going to all this trouble.
Yes, Miss Matthews.
Arson investigator Atherton to see you, Mr. Gilpin.
Oh, yes. Have him come in, please.
Mr. Gilpin, I'm sorry to bother you again. I have to have another talk with you about the fire that destroyed your property.
Well, I thought I covered all that with the man from your department who was here in my office this morning.
Frankly, I'm not satisfied with the report he brought back from that meeting.
What do you mean?
I mean that we are convinced arson was involved.
Well, have you spoken to the insurance company?
I have.
Didn't they tell you they found no evidence of arson?
Yes, but I wanted to talk with you anyway. Another element has entered the case. Murder.
Murder?
The murder of a man named Porter. The man our deputy questioned you about this morning. A man who was seen in the car outside your building.
Yeah, but I told him I'd never heard of the man.
I don't believe you. We made an extensive investigation of your business operations, Mr. Gilpin.
Oh?
Yes, it uncovered some very interesting facts.
Well, what sort of facts?
Facts concerning the dilapidated condition of some of your buildings.
Really?
The one on 12th Street in particular.
I'll sue you.
It's very evident you could have profited nicely from a fire which would have rendered the structure 100% unsalvageable.
This is a preposterous accusation.
I haven't accused you. Yet. But the only person we had under surveillance who could have linked you to this job was Porter. And he's conveniently dead. You're in a bad spot, Mr. Gilpin. Very bad. Yes, Chief, we're making some progress. Well, to bring you up to date, I'm convinced Gilpin's guilty. I went to his office and told him that murder had now been added to the crime of arson, and that we suspected a tie-in between Gilpin and the dead man. Well, he was obviously worried. I also spent nearly 2 hours with Carol Kent going through all the mugshots of old people. I struck out completely there. If we can't find that old couple, Gilpin may get away with this thing. I have one wild idea, Chief. It's 1,000-to-1 shot, but it may work. I'll let you know. Thanks. So long. Hello, Sally. Don Atherton. Didn't you tell me a while back that you had a friend with the Civic Repertory Players Theater, director? Yep, that's the guy. Well, listen. Do me a favor and contact him. Ask him if he knows of an elderly male and female couple who could do a job for us and keep their mouths shut. Sure, they'll be paid. Well, they won't make the kind of dough Richard and Liz make, but on the other hand, they don't have to be sexy. Just elderly. Good. You get back to me, huh? Thanks, Sally.
May I help you?
Is Mr. Gilpin in?
I'm sorry, he's out at the moment. What was it in regard to?
Well, young lady, it's a personal matter.
Would you like to leave a message?
Well, actually, miss, it's both personal and business. We rendered him a service, a very confidential service, and I'm sure he'd like to talk with us about it.
Would you like to leave your name?
Oh, we'd rather not, would we, darling?
Oh, no, I don't think it's necessary. Just tell him we called and that we're in a little trouble. He'll know where to contact us.
Well, it's a little unusual, but I'll tell him.
Well, the service we rendered was a bit unusual, too. Believe me, miss, Mr. Gilpin will understand. Thank you. We'll be on our way. Sorry to have troubled you.
Yes, Chief. I'm in my car across the street from Gilpin's office building. I'm hoping for some action, but I've already been here for an hour. Although he went in, he hasn't come out yet. Uh-oh. Here he comes. He's hailing a cab. One's pulling up now. I'm going to tail him. He's given the driver instructions now. I'll be in touch later. Clear.
Come right in.
Yes.
What can we do for you?
First of all, why did you come to the office? That could lead to some pretty sticky business. Secondly, what kind of trouble are you in?
Trouble?
Yes. You left word with my secretary you were in some kind of trouble.
What are you talking about? We've never been near your office, ever.
But don't try to hand me a snow job. My secretary told me an elderly couple...
Excuse me a moment.
What's that?
I don't know. I'm going to see. Oh, yes?
I'd like to see Mr. Gilpin.
Athen, you followed me here.
What is this?
It's a trap, that's what it is. I was followed because you were dumb enough to come to my office, you old fool.
I told you we never went near your office.
And that's the truth.
You're both lying.
No, Mr. Gilpin, they're telling the truth. I purposely chose a time when I knew you'd be out to send another elderly couple to your office.
What?
I figured you'd lead me to the people who set fire to your building.
You can't get away with entrapment.
Maybe by myself I couldn't. But there are two uniformed men outside. This house is covered. So I suggest you and your friends come along peacefully.
You can't make this stick, Adam. I'm a respectable businessman.
Don't look now, Mr. Gilpin, but your respectability just went up in smoke.
I'm Rod Serling. Close your eyes, exercise your imagination, and join us again on our next presentation of The Zero Hour.
Light My Fire is an original radio drama adapted by Glenn Hall Taylor. Peter Lupus was heard as Don Atherton. Featured in the cast were Jack Edwards, Paula Winslow, Lou Krugman, Jack Crucian, Catherine Grody, and Ruth Anson. Zero Hour, created by J.M. Colas, directed by Don Hills, is produced in Hollywood for the Mutual Broadcasting System by Radio Productions Incorporated. The music is composed and conducted by Stanley D. Hoffman. Rochelle Sherman, associate producer. This has been a presentation of the Mutual Broadcasting System.